Hello all. So now in this section of pharmacology series, we will be discussing about blood coagulation. Now in this blood coagulation, we will be discussing about the drugs which will acting on platelets. Drugs acting on platelets. And there will be two kinds of drugs. We will write these drugs which will promote platelet action is known as proplatelet drugs. And the second class of drug which will inhibit platelet action known as antiplatelet drugs. Okay. Then the second class of drug we will be discussing will be the drugs acting on coagulation. Now coagulation means deposition of fibrin. Okay. So the drugs will be procoagulant drugs. And the second will be anticoagulant drug. Anticoagulant. So anticoagulant will inhibit the deposition of fibrin. And the third class of drug we will be discussing is the drugs which will lyse fibrin. These drugs are known as fibrinolytic drugs. Okay, these drugs are known as fibrinolytic drugs, and their antidote will be known as antifibrinolytic drugs. So these six classes of drugs are the drugs which will be acting on blood coagulation in pharmacology. But remember, fibrinolytic drugs are also known as thrombolytic drugs. And similarly, antifibrinolytics will be antithrombolytic drugs. Okay, so these six classes of drug we have to discuss in blood coagulation. Now basic question arises, sir, why we are discussing that this six classes of drug? Let's discuss the physiology, that how a blood normally functions in our body and how if the bleeding starts, how this bleeding stops. So first we will be discussing about the normal physiology, okay, of blood coagulation. Now we know, suppose this is a blood vessel and these are the endothelial cells, okay. These are the endothelial cells. Now remember, when a blood in a normal condition is a freely flowing liquid, blood is a freely flowing liquid, that we know it continuously functions. The reason is there are certain substances known as platelets and clotting factors. Clotting factors, we will write fibrin. Remember, this platelets and fibrin, they cannot attach to endothelial cell. They cannot attach. Why they cannot attach to endothelial cell? Because these normal endothelial cells, they continuously make a factor into the blood which inhibit their attachment, that is prostaglandin I2, which is also known as prostacyclin, and nitric oxide. Now PgI2 and nitric oxide, remember, they inhibit the attachment of platelets and clotting factors like fibrin. Okay, but this is a normal condition. Now suppose there is some trauma and these endothelial cell gets ruptured. Okay, now there are endothelial cell rupture. So we will write endothelial damage. Now because of this endothelial damage and the blood is a freely flowing liquid, what will happen? Bleeding will start. Okay, bleeding will start. Okay, now to stop this bleeding due to endothelial cell damage, first of all, the platelets will come and it will form a temporary plug. Platelets will come and they will form a temporary plug. Okay. Now, why the platelets will come and form a temporary plug? Because these are the platelets, suppose. These platelets, they will attach to the substances which are present below the endothelial cells. Okay. These platelets can attach to the substances below the endothelial cells like collagen. So can we say if endothelial cell gets ruptured, the collagen will get exposed and the platelets will come and attach to collagen. The reason is on collagen, the platelet have a receptor. Platelets they can bind to collagen with a receptor known as GP1A. GP1A stands for glycoprotein 1A. They have a receptors for collagen. And these surrounding endothelial cells, their physiology becomes, their phenotype will become abnormal. These surrounding endothelial cells will start expressing a factor on their surface known as 1 Willebrand factor. The platelets, they will come and attach to this 1 Willebrand factor as well. Because platelet, they contain receptors for 1 Willebrand factor as well, known as GP1B. That is glycoprotein 1B. So this will form a temporary plug. And this temporary plug formed by the platelet on attachment of collagen and 1 Willebrand factor will stop bleeding. Hence, remember, bleeding time depends upon the number of platelets. So you have to note this point, that time taken by the body to stop bleeding is known as bleeding time. Bleeding time depends upon the number of platelets. Okay. Now the second point is, now we have written that this plug which is formed is a temporary plug. Why it is temporary plug? This wall is just made up of bricks. This is a temporary plug. It is made up of bricks, or these bricks are platelets. Now we have to convert this temporary plug into permanent plug. Because this temporary plug can easily be broken down. It can easily rupture again. So we have to make it into a permanent plug. Now between this bricks or platelet, you have to add a cement. So this cement-like substance which will cause cross-linking of platelet is known as fibrin. Okay, so the second point comes, when the fibrin will come, this fibrin will form a permanent plug. Why? Because it will cause cross-linking of platelets. Understood? So this fibrin will cause cross-linking of platelet. Now remember, this is a platelet, this is a fibrin. Now remember, on this platelets, there are receptors of fibrin as well. The platelets, they contain a receptor of fibrin known as GP2B3A. The receptors of fibrin on platelet is known as GP2B3A. So these receptors are present on platelet. Fibrin will attach to these receptors which is present on platelet. GP2B3A are present on platelets. Okay, and it will form a permanent plug. And this permanent plug cannot rupture easily. This permanent plug cannot rupture easily, but there is a point out here. In our blood, there is no fibrin in blood. Remember, in our blood, there is no fibrin. Okay? Rather, in our blood, there is fibrinogen. We have fibrinogen. Remember, fibrinogen is an inactive molecule. We have to convert this fibrinogen which is present in our blood into fibrin, and only fibrin will cause cross-linking of platelets. Okay, but a basic question arises, how we can convert fibrinogen into fibrin? Remember, the pathway which converts fibrinogen into fibrin is known as clotting pathway. It is also known as clotting cascade. Okay. Now there are two types of clotting pathway which will convert fibrinogen into fibrin. Okay, one is known as extrinsic pathway. Second is known as intrinsic pathway. Okay, now what is the cause why this extrinsic pathway will get activated? Remember, there are 13 clotting factors. And one clotting factor can activate another clotting factor. This is known as cascadic reaction. So what happens in extrinsic pathway when there is endothelial injury? The collagen and 1 Willebrand factor which are released, They are sometimes known as tissue factor as well. There is a tissue factor. Okay. Now this tissue factor will activate factor 7. This factor 7 will activate factor 3, and 3 will activate 10. 7, 3, 10. Similarly, this 10 will activate prothrombin into thrombin, which is factor 2. Okay, which is factor 2. And this thrombin is the only molecule which can convert fibrinogen into fibrin. Okay, and this fibrin can cause platelet aggregation, which will form a temporary plug. So remember, in extrinsic pathway, there should be an endothelial injury. Okay, now the point is, how about intrinsic pathway? Intrinsic pathway gets activated by factor 12. When any negatively charged species comes, it activates factor 12, like high molecular weight kininogen. Okay, it will activate factor 11. 10 is already occupied, right? 9, 7, 8 here. And in them, both of them, they require factor 5 also, or calcium. Okay, so they both will converge in factor 10. From factor 10, can we say a common pathway will be formed? So this pathway is known as common pathway. Okay, above them it is extrinsic and intrinsic pathway. Remember this part. Okay, and the main purpose of both of these pathways is to convert fibrinogen into fibrin. Okay, now the point is, if you want to test the activity of fibrin deposition through extrinsic pathway, the activity of extrinsic pathway is diagnosed by a test known as prothrombin time. Okay, prothrombin time, or PT. The activity of intrinsic pathway is tested by a test known as APTT. APTT is activated partial thromboplastin time. Okay, now how to do this prothrombin time? We take out the blood in the patient. We take out the blood outside in our tube, and we touch this tube with an artificial tissue factor, PT test. Artificial tissue factor. This artificial tissue factor is known as thromboplastin. And then we see that how much time will this blood will take to clot or the fibrin to deposit. Okay. Similarly, we take out the blood in APTT and we test this blood with a negatively charged glass rod that will activate factor 12, or you can write kaolin, or we will touch with by dye atoms, because all of them, they carry negatively charged static current on their surface. So this is how we will do APTT test. And when we talk about this common pathway, we should do both PT as well as APTT. But better is always PT, okay, prothrombin time. So this is how fibrin will deposit. Now the third point arises, don't you think, if this fibrin will get deposited in excessive manner, if this fibrin will get deposited in excessive manner, what can happen? Can we say that this blood vessel may block again if there is excessive deposition of fibrin? Remember, to prevent this excessive deposition, or to prevent excessive coagulation, we have a mechanism known as fibrinolysis. We have a mechanism known as fibrinolysis. Now let's see how fibrinolysis occurs. There is a protein which is circulating in our plasma that is known as plasminogen. Okay, this plasminogen is in a free form. And when there is excessive deposition of fibrin, this plasminogen comes and bind to fibrin. This is known as bound plasminogen. Okay, bound plasminogen. But now remember, as we have written a word ogen, plasminogen means right now it is an inactive state. When there is excessive deposition of fibrin, these endothelial cells, they release a factor into the blood known as TPA. TPA stands for tissue plasminogen activator. Okay, This TPA will convert specifically, remember this word is very important, it will convert specifically plasminogen which is bound to fibrin, bound plasminogen, this one, not this one, free wala nahi, bound wala. So plasminogen, bound plasminogen into active form known as plasmin. It will convert specifically the bound plasminogen into active form plasmin. And remember, this plasmin is a type of protease enzyme. It is a type of protease enzyme. It will cause fibrin degradation. It will cause fibrin degradation, which is known as fibrinolysis. Okay. So excessive deposition of fibrin is prevented by a mechanism known as fibrinolysis. But my question arises from that if there is excessive activation of fibrinolysis, if you will remove this fibrin degradation excessively, what can happen? If there is excessive degradation of fibrin, what can happen? If there is excessive degradation of fibrin, don't you think again bleeding will start? If there is excessive fibrinolysis, it may lead to bleeding. Because of this, to prevent this excessive fibrinolysis, we have a mechanism known as antifibrinolysis. To prevent excessive fibrinolysis, we have antifibrinolytic. There is another protein secreted by endothelial cell. That protein is known as PAI1N2. PAI1N2 will inhibit this TPA. So what is this antifibrinolytic? We will write, there is a protein when there is excessive fibrinolysis secreted by the same endothelial cell known as PAI1N2. PAI1N2 stands for plasminogen activator inhibitor. So that means it will inhibit that protein which is activating a plasminogen. Which molecule was activating a plasminogen? That was TPA. So this molecule will inhibit TPA. And this process will stop. Hence, excessive fibrinolysis will be inhibited by PAI1N2. So this tells that everything in our body occurs in a very regulated fashion, in a very balanced way. Okay? So this is the normal physiological mechanism. So keeping this thing in mind, now we will be starting about the drugs. The first drug, class of drug, we will be discussing about the drugs acting on platelets. Okay? The first class of drug we will be writing about drugs acting on platelets. So the drugs, let's discuss about now the drugs which are acting on platelets. Now the drugs which are acting on platelets can be divided into two. Either the drugs which will inhibit platelet function, they are known as antiplatelets, and the drugs which increases platelet number and functions, they are known as proplatelets. Okay? So they can be divided conveniently into antiplatelets and proplatelets. So antiplatelet drugs, remember, they inhibit platelet function, as the name implies. So in the first section, let's discuss with a topic known as antiplatelet drugs. Okay? Antiplatelets. Because antiplatelet, they will reduce the function of platelet, they will increase. Okay. So before starting with antiplatelet drugs, let's discuss about the physiology by which how platelet functions normally. Okay. How platelet functions. So platelet functions in, we will summarize the platelet function in three steps. The first step is known as platelet attachment. Platelet attachment. Or you can write adhesion also. Now what happens, we have already discussed, when there is endothelial cell damage, the substances below the endothelial cell, they get exposed. One of the substance which is below the endothelial cell, when it gets damaged, it's exposed as collagen. And the surrounding endothelial cell, they change their phenotype. Normally platelet cannot attach on endothelial cell, but the surrounding endothelial cell, they start expressing one Willebrand factor. Okay. Now the platelets, they come, suppose this is a platelet, they come and attach to von Willebrand factor and collagen, okay, and they will form a plug. They will form a plug. Now how platelet attaches to von Willebrand factor and collagen,
Now remember, platelet, it contains a receptor known as GP1A. Now GP1A, which is present on platelet, acts on collagen, which is secreted by fibroblast. And it also has a receptor known as GP1B. Now GP1B, remember, it attaches to von Willebrand factor. It attaches to von Willebrand factor. Okay, and GP, remember, here stands for, GP stands for glycoprotein. So they are glycoprotein 1A and 1A receptor, which is responsible for platelet attachment. So this is the first step. Now the point is, when the platelet attaches, the second substance, the second step in platelet function is platelet recruitment. Platelet recruitment. Now what happens, suppose a platelet has attached to collagen. Suppose this platelet has attached to collagen or von Willebrand factor, this platelet releases certain chemical mediators. It releases certain chemical mediators which tells the more platelet, which will tell more platelets to come here and make a wall out here, which will cause platelet recruitment. So the point is, platelet will release certain chemicals which will lead to more recruitment of platelet. Okay, now let's see how platelet recruitment occurs in more detail. Suppose a platelet gets attached to collagen. What happens when it attaches to collagen? A part of cell membrane of platelet breaks down. This part of cell membrane which breaks down and come into the platelet is arachidonic acid. Arachidonic acid, which is a product from phospholipid membranes of platelet, will break down and it will come into the cytoplasm. It is known as arachidonic acid. It will enter into the cytoplasm. So it gets degraded from platelet cell membrane and come into cytoplasm. Now when arachidonic acid comes into the cytoplasm, remember, there is an enzyme which is present in the platelet known as COX-1 enzyme. COX-1 stands for cyclooxygenase enzyme. This cyclooxygenase 1 enzyme, COX-1 enzyme, will rapidly convert platelet into thromboxane A2. It will rapidly convert arachidonic acid into thromboxane A2. Okay, thromboxane A2. Okay, now this thromboxane A2, remember, it opens potassium, it opens calcium channel. It opens calcium channel. So calcium will enter into the platelet and the platelet will depolarize. And the platelet will depolarize. Remember, when the platelet gets depolarized, the chemical substances which are present in the platelet as a granules, they will fuse with the cell membrane. When they will fuse with the cell membrane, because of depolarization, these chemicals are released into the blood. Okay? So it will release, you will write, this thromboxane A2 will release chemical factors. And one of the very important chemical factor is ADP. You will write, it will release ADP, adenosine diphosphate, into the blood. Now remember, this ADP, when released into the blood, it will go to the other platelets. It will go to the other platelets. And it will tell the platelet to come and aggregate. So remember, this ADP causes platelet recruitment. It will cause platelet recruitment. Now how this ADP causes platelet recruitment? This ADP will go to the other platelets. Other platelets. And it will act on a receptor on other platelet known as P2Y12 receptor. So P2Y12, P stand for purine. Okay, so P2Y12 is a receptor of ADP. P2Y12 is a receptor of ADP. It's a GI type of G protein coupled receptor, GI type, which decreases cyclic AMP level. Which decreases cyclic AMP level. When cyclic AMP level inside the platelet decreases, remember, the platelet recruitment occurs. Okay, platelet recruitment occurs. So this is the pathway of platelet recruitment. But you have to remember that ADP is not the only substance which is released by the platelet. Why we are giving stress on ADP? Because we have a drug which will inhibit this P2Y12 receptor. Okay, But there are other chemicals also which are released by the platelet known as serotonin, platelet activating factor, thrombin, etc. Many other factors are also released. But what is more important out here is ADP. Okay, so this is how more platelet will come and form a plug. Now the third step of platelet action is platelet aggregation. The third step is platelet aggregation. Now when these platelets have recruited together, we will form cross-linking of platelet. What we will do? We will do cross-linking of platelet to form a permanent plug. We have already discussed that aggregation of platelet, that platelets are linked together by a clotting factor known as fibrin. Fibrin is responsible for aggregation of platelet, remember. Now how fibrin causes aggregation of platelet? Remember, on platelet there is a receptor for fibrin also. The receptor of fibrin on platelet is GP, 2B, 3A receptor. This GP stands for glycoprotein 2B 3A receptor causes platelet aggregation. Okay, it causes platelet aggregation, and platelet aggregation is caused by fibrin. So this is the normal physiology by which platelet aggregation occurs. Now let's start with a list of antiplatelet drugs. Okay, let's write the first list of antiplatelet drugs. Okay, so the first class of drug, what we will be doing in antiplatelet drug, we will be inhibiting this pathway. The first class of drug we will be having will be COX inhibitor. It will inhibit COX enzyme, thereby thromboxane A2 will not be formed. Then we will be having a drug known as ADP receptor blocker. They will block the receptors of ADP. Then we will be having GP2B3A inhibitors. And also we will be having certain drugs which will increase the level of cyclic AMP in the platelet, because reduction in cyclic AMP causes platelet recruitment. So let's write the names of antiplatelet drug. The first class of antiplatelet drug we have is irreversible COX inhibitor. COX stands for cyclooxygenase enzyme. And the most famous drug which is used is aspirin. Okay, aspirin. Remember, COX inhibitors are also known as non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. COX inhibitors, they are also known as non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. All NSAIDs are reversible inhibitor of COX enzyme. The only irreversible inhibitor is aspirin. The only irreversible inhibitor we have is aspirin. Okay, the second class of drug we will be writing is ADP receptor blocker. So those will block the receptor of ADP. If you remember, what was the name of the receptor of ADP? That was P2Y12 receptor. So they are also known as P2Y12 antagonist or blocker. Blocker and antagonist are same thing. Okay, same word. Now these drugs, they are divided into two. Either they are irreversible blocker, okay, or they are reversible blocker. Or they are reversible blocker. Now among irreversible blocker, we will write the names. The drugs are T, C and P. And here we will write a drug T and C. T stand for ticlopidine. It's very important to remember their names. Clopidogrel, prasugrel, ticagrelor. Among reversible, we will write ticagrelor and cangrelor. Now, how to remember their names? As you are seeing, the names grel word is coming and grelor word is coming. Okay? But ticlopidine is a different name, so you must remember this name. Now, the third class of drug we are having is GP, 2B, 3A inhibitors. Okay, so can we say that they will inhibit platelet aggregation? Okay, the drugs among them we are having are three drugs, EAT. Okay, three drugs are there. The first drug you will write is EPT, fibatide. The drug name is eptifibatide. Second is epcixmab. It's a monoclonal antibody. Mab word is coming. And tirofiban. Tirofiban. Okay. So these are the drugs. The fourth class of drug we will write is, that is, fourth class of drug we will write is phosphodiesterase inhibitors. Okay. Now, what is the function of phosphodiesterase enzyme? The function of phosphodiesterase enzyme is to degrade cyclic AMP. Okay. So, if we will inhibit this phosphodiesterase enzyme, the level of cyclic AMP increases, and we know that cyclic AMP inhibit platelet action. Okay. They inhibit platelet action. So remember, cyclic AMP is degraded into 5-AMP. Its cyclical structure is opened by phosphodiesterase enzyme. So the drugs are, we will write DCP, dipyridamole, celostazole, and pentoxifilline. Okay, sometime we also write F instead of phi, okay, filine, pentoxifilline. And the new class of drug we will be writing, a new class, is PAR inhibitors, PAR1 inhibitors. So these are the drugs which are approved. Now PAR stands for protease activated receptor. Okay, the drug you will write right now is Vorapexar. How to remember? PAR word is coming. X means inhibitor. Vorapexar. Now, what is PAR receptor? That we will be discussing shortly. Okay? That we will be discussing shortly. Now, before starting with each of the following drug, let's see what are the uses of antiplatelet drugs. Common uses. What are the common uses of antiplatelet drugs? Remember, common uses, antiplatelet drugs are used in the treatment of those diseases which are due to platelet-rich thrombi. Which are due to platelet thrombi. Now, what do we mean by the word thrombi? Thrombi means excessive deposition of platelet. If this platelet becomes excessively deposited, don't you think it will block a blood vessel? It will block a blood vessel. Remember, platelet-rich thrombi is also known as white thrombi. Now, this white thrombi, remember, it occurs mainly in arteries. It mainly is formed in arteries. Suppose this is an artery, and due to, let's say, atherosclerosis, there is narrowing of artery. Suppose there is atherosclerosis, and due to atherosclerosis, there is narrowing artery. Atherosclerosis. Because atherosclerosis, you must be knowing, it is due to deposition of fats, lipids, etc. There is narrowing of blood. Now remember, when a blood vessel becomes narrowed, the blood which moves from this narrow space, its speed increases. Like you have seen, when you give a water in garden and you narrow the pipe by which you are pouring a water, the speed increases. Due to this shear blood flow, shear means tearing blood flow. Due to this shearing blood flow, this endothelial cell gets ruptured. This endothelial cell gets ruptured, or endothelial injury. And if endothelial cell gets ruptured, the first substance which will come and attach on endothelial cell will be platelets. It will lead to attachment of platelets. And if this platelet will become excessively attached, it will block a blood vessel. Now, the problem will arise in those blood vessels which are end arteries. Now, end arteries means that it is the only artery which is supplying a particular organ. Let's say coronary arteries are end arteries. Okay? Every heart tissue has only one blood supply. End artery means only one blood supply. And if this blood supply becomes blocked, can we say it will lead to MI, that is myocardial infarction? Remember, cerebral arteries are also end arteries. it will lead to stroke. Okay, and similarly in any other organ, if it is blocked, it is known as peripheral vascular disease. It is known as peripheral vascular disease, like Berger's disease. In Berger's disease, the limb arteries get blocked. Okay, Berger's disease. So these are the three main conditions in which arterial rich thrombi is formed, and we use antiplatelet drugs in these conditions. This is the main use of antiplatelet drugs. So antiplatelet drugs, they are used due to blockage of coronary artery by platelet, cerebral artery, and any other area known as peripheral vascular disease. Berger disease occurs in limb arteries. Okay, so there will be limb ischemia. Okay, so remember, antiplatelet drugs, they are used in these conditions. So keeping this thing in mind, let's start with the first drug, that is aspirin. Now, what is aspirin? Aspirin, we know, is an NSAID, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, and it is a COX inhibitor. And in which fashion it inhibits COX enzyme? Remember, irreversible inhibitor. Remember, if a drug binds to an enzyme irreversibly, the bond which is formed by the drug is covalent bond. And this enzyme will become permanently dead. Because of this reason, any drug which inhibits an enzyme irreversibly is known as suicide inhibition. It is known as suicide inhibitor because now this enzyme is permanently dead. It is also known as hit and run drug. It will come, it will hit, and the action, this enzyme will be permanently dead. So it is also known as hit and run drug. Now let's see why we use aspirin among NSAID as an antiplatelet drug. Remember, among all NSAIDs, only aspirin is used as an antiplatelet drug. No other NSAID is used except one. There is a new drug which is not available in most of the country. That drug is triflusal. It is also a same drug like aspirin. Triflusal is also an NSAID, which is also a COX inhibitor. But remember, we use aspirin. Now let's see what is the rationale of using aspirin. Why aspirin is the only NSAID which is used as an antiplatelet drug. So remember, aspirin is the only NSAID which is used as an antiplatelet drug. No other NSAID is used. Okay. Why? Because all other NSAIDs are reversible inhibitor. So let's see what is the rationale. So suppose this is a blood vessel. Remember, in blood vessel there are platelets, and platelets, they contain COX-1 enzyme, and this, there is endothelial cells. Endothelial cells, remember, contains COX-2 enzyme. Okay, now remember that when platelets form COX-1 enzyme, it forms thromboxane A2, and thromboxane A2 increases platelet attachment or platelet aggregation. Okay, but what about endothelial cells? Remember, endothelial cells, if we talk about endothelial cells, they form prostaglandin I2 by COX-2 enzyme. Prostaglandin I2 is known as prostacycline. It is known as prostacycline. Remember, prostacycline has just opposite action. It reduces or inhibits platelet attachment. That we have already discussed. It inhibits platelet attachment. Now the first step is, when we give aspirin, remember, when we give aspirin to our patient, remember, aspirin will inhibit COX-1 enzyme, and aspirin will also inhibit COX-2 enzyme. Aspirin inhibits both COX-1 and COX-2. It inhibits COX-1 as well as COX-2 both. Okay, so can we say that initially the level of thromboxane A2 will reduce and the level of PGI2 will also reduce? Okay, now the point is, we know that aspirin is an irreversible inhibitor. Irreversible means that this enzyme now is permanently dead. Now, if we want to regain the function of COX enzyme, This enzyme cannot function. We need a new enzyme. To regain the function, we need a new enzyme. And remember, all new enzymes, they are proteins. They are formed from nucleus. They are formed in nucleus. They are formed from DNA transcription or from nucleus. Now, the point is, if you want a new COX enzyme, you need a nucleus and you need a DNA transcription. Remember, platelets. There is no nucleus in the platelet. So platelet, they don't have DNA. There is no DNA in the platelet. While endothelial cells, they have nucleus, they have DNA. So what will happen? The level of thromboxane A2 will become permanently low. It will become permanently low, but endothelial cells, they can make fresh enzyme. They can make fresh enzyme. Because of this reason, the level of PGI2 will increase. The level of PGI2 will increase because endothelial cell, they can make new COX enzyme. They can make new COX enzyme. So the level will shift towards, the balance will shift towards PGI2. And we know that PGI2 inhibit platelet attachment. Hence, aspirin is an antiplatelet drug because it will shift the balance towards prostaglandin I2. Thromboxane A2 will become permanently dead. Understood this point? Now, why we are not using reversible inhibitor? Why we are not using reversible NSAIDs? Because if you will give reversible NSAID, this same COX enzyme can again function. The level of thromboxane A2 can increase. Okay? So, because of this reason, we use aspirin only. Okay. Now, let's talk about what are the uses and what is the dose of aspirin. Dose and route. Remember, aspirin is only given orally. And the antiplatelet dose of aspirin. The antiplatelet dose of aspirin is around 50 to 325 milligram. This is the antiplatelet dose of aspirin. Remember, in higher dose. In higher dose, aspirin has antipyretic effect. It will reduce fever. And in still higher dose, it will have anti-inflammatory effect. The antipyretic dose of aspirin is around 700 to 800 milligram. And anti-inflammatory dose is 2 to 5 grams. So can we say that in low dose, aspirin is a selective antiplatelet drug. Low dose aspirin is a selective antiplatelet drug. So it will not reduce fever or inflammation in low dose. Okay. So as an antiplatelet drug, aspirin is used as a antiplatelet drug. Okay. But what about its antipyretic and anti-inflammatory use? Please refer to the videos of autocoids, where we have discussed aspirin in great detail, what are the uses as antipyretic and anti-inflammatory. Now the point is, let's see the antiplatelet uses of aspirin. Remember, aspirin is the drug of choice for MI, stroke, and peripheral vascular disease. Drug of choice in all these three conditions. So it is the main drug. Peripheral vascular disease, you can write as Berger's disease. It is the drug of choice. Okay. Now, remember the point that aspirin is the drug of choice for MI and stroke. It is the drug of choice for both acute attack of MI. And when a patient of acute attack of MI you will give aspirin. And when you have treated this MI and stroke, you will put that patient on lifelong aspirin. So it is also the drug of choice for secondary prophylaxis. Secondary prophylaxis means that it will decrease the recurrence of MI and stroke in future. It will further reduce the chances of occurrence of MI and stroke in future. Okay. Now, what should be the dose of aspirin in acute attack? Remember, when the patient of aspirin, acute attack of aspirin comes, remember, give the highest possible dose of antiplatelet drug. What is the highest possible dose? The highest possible dose we give is 325 milligram. 325 milligram. And secondary prophylaxis we give 75 milligram. Okay, 75 milligram lifelong. It is around 75 to 80 milligram. But remember, it should always be less than 100. It should always be less than 100. Okay. So sometimes you will find the tablets of Disprin in the hospital. Disprin tablets. Disprin tablet contains 75 milligram. So when a patient, sometimes we don't have 325 milligram. So in emergency, if a patient of acute attack comes to us, what we say that patient, take 4 tablets of Disprin and chew it and eat it. Chew it. Because 4 tablets of Disprin will contain around 300 milligram of aspirin. Okay. So when you don't have any tablet of 325 milligram, give 4 tablets of Disprin during an acute attack. Understood? So let's talk about now the side effects of aspirin. Remember, all antiplatelet drugs, their most common side effect is bleeding. Because the function of platelet is to stop bleeding. An antiplatelet drug, they will prolong bleeding, hence there will be increase in bleeding time. All antiplatelet drug, they will increase bleeding time. Okay, most common side effect. Now second, remember, as aspirin is an NSAID, and NSAIDs, remember, they cause peptic ulcers. NSAIDs, they cause peptic ulcers. Now why it causes peptic ulcer? The reason is this COX-1 enzyme. This COX-1 enzyme is present in stomach also. And in stomach, COX-1 enzyme forms prostaglandin E2. It forms prostaglandin E2. Remember, prostaglandin E2 decreases HCl production and it increases bicarbonate and mucus production. So this HCl, bicarbonate and mucus, they are protective factors. They protect the stomach cell from HCl, which is present in the lumen, and in presence of HCl, pepsin enzyme acts. So this bicarbonate and mucus, they form a protective barrier over the stomach cell. Now remember, as aspirin is a COX inhibitor, the level of prostaglandin E2 decreases. Hence, the level of HCl will increase and the protective factors will reduce. This bicarbonate and pepsin will damage the own stomach cell. Okay, hence all NSAIDs, they cause peptic ulcer. Now what is the drug of choice for treatment of NSAID induced peptic ulcer? Remember, the drug of choice for treatment of NSAID induced peptic ulcer is PPI, that is proton pump inhibitors, because they are the most effective and safest drug. So the drugs are, they will end with the word prazole, like omeprazole, pantoprazole, rabeprazole, etc. Okay, and remember, PPIs are the drug of choice for all types of peptic ulcer. But remember, you can also give one drug, that is misoprostol. Okay, misoprostol. Misoprostol is synthetic prostaglandin E1 analog. Now E2 has two double bond. 2 means 2 double bond. In misoprostol, it is also PGE2, but it has 1 double bond. Okay, so it can also be given misoprostol, but remember, the drug of choice is PPI. But misoprostol is a specific drug for NSAID induced peptic ulcer. It is a specific drug for NSAID induced peptic ulcer. It is not used in any other cause of peptic ulcer. It is not used in H. pylori induced peptic ulcer, stress ulcer. In all peptic ulcer, the drug of choice is PPIs, including NSAID induced peptic ulcers. Okay. Now, let's talk about now precautions. While giving aspirin, what precautions you should take? Now, aspirin should be avoided with anticoagulants like heparin or warfarin. Remember, anticoagulant and antiplatelet drug, they will together increase the risk of severe bleeding. Okay, anticoagulant means they will inhibit the deposition of fibrin. Antiplatelet, they will inhibit the deposition of platelet. Second, aspirin should be stopped 2 to 3 days before surgery. Okay, 2 to 3 days before surgery. Okay, because during surgery, when we give an incision, there is bleeding. If you will give an antiplatelet drug, the bleeding will not stop. Okay, so this is all about aspirin. Now let's talk about now second class of drug, that is ADP. Second class of drug we have now is ADP receptor blockers. They are also known as P2 Y12 blockers or antagonists. We have already discussed their names. We know that platelet, it contains P2 Y12 receptor. And ADP, which is released by the platelet, act on P2 Y12 receptor. It's GI type. It reduces cyclic AMP level, and cyclic AMP level increases platelet action. So what we will be doing, we will block this receptor. We will block this receptor. So the first class of drug we have, remember, before writing the first class of drug, remember all these drugs, first common point, remember all these drugs are oral drugs, which we will be discussing, and all drugs are prodrugs. Prodrugs means that these drugs, they themselves are inactive drug. They go in the body and they get converted into active metabolite. Okay, so all ADP receptor blocker are oral drug. And they all are prodrug except we will write cangrelor. Okay, cangrelor. Remember, cangrelor is an intravenous drug and it is not a prodrug. It itself is an active drug. Prodrugs are inactive drug. They go into the body and gets converted into active form. It itself is an active drug. So the exception out here is cangrelor. Okay, so let's talk about first class of drug, that is irreversible ADP receptor blocker, irreversible blockers. So among irreversible blocker, we have written three drugs, TCP, if you remember, that is ticlopidine, okay, clopidogrel. And lastly, prasugrel. These are three drugs. So they all are prodrugs. We know ticlopidine is a prodrug, clopidogrel is a prodrug, prasugrel is a prodrug. Okay. Now let's talk about their uses first. Okay, uses. Remember, ticlopidine is used in MI, stroke, and peripheral vascular disease. Okay, peripheral vascular disease. Now remember, it is also given during angioplasty. When you are putting a stent, metallic stent, angioplasty. And the same uses, if you will write, the same are the uses of clopidogrel. Exactly same. Okay. But what about prasugrel? Remember, in prasugrel, we will write that prasugrel is not used in cases of stroke. Cut this stroke and write here MI, peripheral vascular disease, and you will write not stroke. Because I will tell you, prasugrel will increase the risk of stroke due to bleeding. Okay. Now, the second point is, if you talk about their side effects, this ticlopidine is the most toxic drug. So ticlopidine is a toxic drug, because of this reason, nowadays not used. Hence, the uses of ticlopidine are taken by clopidogrel. So instead of ticlopidine, nowadays we use clopidogrel. So let's write the side effects of ticlopidine now. The most common side effect of ticlopidine is It causes diarrhea. It also causes breathlessness, dyspnea. Okay? It also causes TTP. TTP stands for thrombotic, thrombocytopenic, because platelet count is less, purpura. Okay? But what is the most dangerous one? Why we are not using it? The most dangerous side effect of ticlopidine, we will write, is bone marrow suppression. Because of the fear of this bone marrow suppression, nowadays we don't use ticlopidine. In bone marrow suppression, remember, it causes neutropenia and thrombocytopenia. Remember, neutropenia is also here known as agranulocytosis. Neutropenia is also known as agranulocytosis. That means granulocytes are not dividing. Okay? Because of the fear of bone marrow suppression, we have stopped using ticlopidine. Now, what about clopidogrel? We will write clopidogrel, same side effects, but rarely or no bone marrow suppression. Very rare. So, bone marrow suppression is not seen generally with clopidogrel. Clopidogrel also causes diarrhea, dyspnea, and thrombotic, thrombocytopenic, purpura, same side effect, but the risk of bone marrow is very less. Okay? Now, what about prasugrel? Remember, prasugrel, we will write, it causes profuse bleeding. It causes profuse bleeding. It causes maximum risk of bleeding. Because of its profuse bleeding, what we have seen, that prasugrel causes increase the risk of hemorrhagic stroke. Prasugrel increases the risk of hemorrhagic stroke because of severe bleeding. That is why we don't give prasugrel in stroke patient. Okay? Because it causes profuse bleeding. And it is also contraindicated, remember, in old age patient. More than 75 years of age, because there is increased risk of stroke in that patient. Okay? It is also it is contraindicated in 75 years of age. Okay? Now, the next point we will write is a very important point for clopidogrel. A last point with clopidogrel is, remember, this clopidogrel, we have already discussed that this clopidogrel is a prodrug. And it goes into the body and it gets converted into active form. Prodrugs are inactive drug, they get converted into active form. Its active form is known as 2-oxoclopidogrel. And it is converted in the liver by an enzyme known as CYP2C19 enzyme. CYP stands for cytochrome P enzyme. So CYP2C19 enzyme, they convert this clopidogrel into active form. But there is a point out here. The point out here is, there is a class of drug known as proton pump inhibitors like omeprazole, etc. Remember, omeprazole, they are CYP2C19 inhibitors. They are CYP2C19 inhibitors. Because of this reason, they will inhibit this CYP2C19. They inhibit the conversion of clopidogrel into active form. Hence, proton pump inhibitor should never be combined. It should not be combined with clopidogrel. It should not be combined. Why we were giving omeprazole? Because omeprazole was the drug of choice for aspirin-induced peptic ulcer. So we have to give omeprazole, but when we give omeprazole with clopidogrel, it should not be combined. Okay, so omeprazole, remember, it should be combined with aspirin, but not with clopidogrel. Okay, now the last point is, remember, ADP. Okay, so now last point is reversible blockers. Among reversible blockers, we have two drugs, T and C. T for ticagrelor. And C for cangrelor. Ticagrelor, cangrelor. Now, why we have made this reversible blocker? Because they are safer. Safer than irreversible blocker. Why they are safer than irreversible blocker? If you will stop this drug, can we say ADP can now again function? So they will have less risk of bleeding. Because of its safety profile, nowadays we prefer to use them. Now remember, this ticagrelor is an oral drug and cangrelor is a IV drug, and cangrelor is not a prodrug also. Okay, so the point is, where ticagrelor is used, the use of ticagrelor is same like prasugrel. Same like prasugrel. So it is used in MI and peripheral vascular disease, not in stroke patient. Because right now it has not been evaluated in stroke patient, it is contraindicated. Now where you need to give an injectable IV drug, remember IV drugs are given when we are doing some emergency procedure in a patient. So it is given during angioplasties. When you are putting a metallic stent or doing balloon angioplasty, patient cannot take a drug orally. We give intravenous antiplatelet drug. So this angioplasty you can write is PTCA. PTCA stands for percutaneous transluminal coronary angioplasty. Coronary angioplasty, A for angioplasty. So it is given during that. Now, what is the overall status of ADP receptor blocker? Remember, ADP receptor blockers, they are combined with aspirin. They are combined with aspirin because aspirin, we have discussed, was the drug of choice for MI, stroke and peripheral vascular disease. And they are given in cases of MI, stroke and peripheral vascular disease. And what we have seen, when we combine ADP receptor blocker with aspirin, it is a synergistic combination. It shows synergistic combination. Why it shows synergistic combination? Because they are acting in the same sequence. We have discussed that arachidonic acid was converted into thromboxane A2 with the help of COX enzyme. And this thromboxane A2 releases ADP from the platelet. ADP goes to on the other platelet, blocks P2Y12. Now what aspirin will do? Aspirin will inhibit COX enzyme and they will block P2Y12 receptors. So they are acting in the same sequence. So their actions are additive action. So their action will become additive. So they show synergistic action. Synergism means that in long term, they can decrease, they can reduce mortality in MI and stroke patient. So when they are combined together, they can even better reduce mortality in MI stroke patient, even better than aspirin alone. So they can reduce mortality in future mortality in patient even better than when we were giving aspirin alone. If you will add ADP receptor blocker, the chances of survival increases. Okay, chances of survival increases. So it's a synergistic combination. Now let's talk about the third class of drug, that is GP 2B 3A inhibitors. Okay, now GP 2B 3A receptor was present on platelets, and on this receptor, remember, fibrin attaches. And fibrin causes platelet aggregation. So it is responsible for aggregation of platelet. It is responsible for aggregation of platelet. So we will block this receptor GP2B3A. Okay. Now remember, this GP2B3A, it's a part of this receptor, glycoprotein 2B3A. It's a part of integrin family. Integrin family is a part of receptors on which fibrin and various other WBCs, RBCs can attach. It's a part of integrin family. And it is which type of integrin? We will write it is known as alpha-2B and beta-3 integrin. It is known as alpha-2B, beta-3 integrin. So integrin have a specific nomenclature. So GP2B3A is also known as alpha-2B-beta-3 integrin. It is another name of GP2B3A. That is why GP2B3A inhibitors, they are also known as anti-integrin drugs. They are also known as anti-integrin drug because GP2B3A is a type of integrin on which plate fibrin can attach. And they are also known as anti-aggregant drugs because fibrin is responsible for aggregation of platelet or cross-linking of platelets. Okay. Now, let's see what are the drugs we have among GP2B3A inhibitor and where they are used. So, let's see what are the drugs. Remember, there are three drugs and all these drugs are IV drugs, intravenous drug. And where would you like to give an intravenous drug as an antiplatelet drug? Remember, they are given during PTCA or angioplasty. IV drugs, they are given during angioplasty as an add-on drug to aspirin. As an add-on drug to aspirin. So let's see what are the drugs we have. So we have three drugs. We have already written EATEAT. E stands for eptifibatide. So their names are very important. GP2B3A inhibitor, eptifibatide, apsiximab, and tirofiban. So they all are intravenous drug and they all are used during angioplasty procedure as an add-on drug to aspirin. Eptifibatide, apsiximab, tirofiban. Okay. Now let's talk about what is their chemical nature, where they are used. Remember, eptifibatide is a cyclical peptide. MAB word is coming, it's a monoclonal antibody. Tirofiban is non-peptide. It's a non-peptide. Okay. Now remember, this apsiximab has additional immunosuppressive property because it also blocks certain other integrin also, like vitronectin, etc. Because of this reason, it reduces the immunity of the body. So this drug has been tried in various autoimmune conditions like Crohn's disease, etc. But right now it is not approved. Now the last point is apsiximab. Remember, it is safe in renal failure. It is safe in renal failure as well. But tirofiban and eptifibatide, they are unsafe and contraindicated. Both are unsafe and contraindicated in renal failure. So eptifibatide and tirofiban are not given in renal failure. Apsiximab has two important points: additional anti-inflammatory property or immunosuppressive property, safe in renal failure. Okay. Now let's talk about the fourth class of drug, that is PAR1 inhibitors. Now PAR stands for protease activated receptor 1. Now what is this PAR receptor? Let's understand. Suppose this is a blood vessel and there are endothelial cells. Remember, on the surface of endothelial cells we have PAR receptors. PAR1 receptor is present. Now this PAR receptor is a receptor of a molecule, a clotting factor known as thrombin. When thrombin attaches to PAR, it activates thrombin. So what is the function of PAR receptor? To activate thrombin. And we already know that thrombin, it causes platelet attachment. It causes, increases platelet attachment. Okay, thrombin, remember, causes recruitment and attachment of platelets. Okay, so remember this part. Hence, what we will be doing, we will block this receptor. We will inhibit this receptor known as PAR1 inhibitors. So PAR1 inhibitors, they will inhibit activation of thrombin. They will inhibit activation of thrombin. and thrombin now cannot activate platelets. So what are the drugs? The drug we have is name is Vorapexar. It is the only approved drug. There are other drugs also, but those are not approved. That is Etopexar. You'll write not approved. So what you have to remember, the name of Vorapexar. This is an important drug. How to remember their name? As you're seeing, PAR word is coming. PAR word is coming. Now where it is used, remember this Vorapexar is an oral drug. Okay. And remember, it is given as an add-on drug to aspirin, because aspirin was a drug of choice everywhere in myocardial infarction and peripheral vascular disease. And like prasugrel, it is also contraindicated in stroke patient. So a very important drug, Vorapexar. And the last class of antiplatelet drug now we will be writing is phospho, diesterase inhibitors. So the last class of drug we are writing is phosphodiesterase inhibitors. Now phosphodiesterase, remember, is an enzyme which is responsible for degradation of cyclic AMP in the platelet, PDE. And if we inhibit this phosphodiesterase enzyme, the level of cyclic AMP increases. Remember, cyclic AMP inhibit platelet aggregation. Okay, so phosphodiesterase inhibitor, they will increase the level of cyclic AMP inside the platelets. So what are the drugs? We will write the names of the drugs. D, CP. That is, first drug is dipyridamole. Okay, so other drug we will discuss like cilostazol and P for pentoxifilin. So first let's talk about dipyridamole. Okay, now dipyridamole, P word is coming, P for 5 or 5, you will write it is a phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor. It is a phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor. Which type? 5 type. Plus, it also causes adenosine reuptake inhibitor, or it causes adenosine efflux. It also causes adenosine efflux. Remember, it inhibits this enzyme, it also removes adenosine into the blood. Remember, adenosine is a very powerful vasodilator. It is a very powerful vasodilator as well, adenosine. Now let's see what are the uses. Remember, this dipyridamole, if you talk about the use, its use is just opposite to prasugrel. Remember, it is given in stroke patient. Okay? Prasugrel was contraindicated in stroke patient. Dipyridamole is given in stroke patient. While it is contraindicated in MI. So it will have an opposite effect. All other drugs we were seeing that they were given in MI but contraindicated in stroke. Dipyridamole is given in stroke patient. Okay. Now in stroke patient, remember, it is given as an add-on drug to aspirin. Okay. Now the second use is, it has recently been approved as an add-on drug to warfarin. Warfarin is an anticoagulant in prosthetic heart wall patient. Because prosthetic heart wall can also lead to thrombi formation. Artificial heart wall, thrombus can form. Okay. Now, why it is contraindicated in MI? Because it causes a syndrome known as coronary Steel syndrome. It causes coronary Steel syndrome. This is very important. Now, what is coronary Steel syndrome? As we know that it is a vasodilator. Remember, it dilates coronary artery in non-ischemic area. In non-ischemic area. So what will happen if there is a coronary artery which is having very less blood supply, its blood supply will be diverted into non-ischemic area. It will further reduce or compromise the blood supply in coronary arteries. So for the complete concept of coronary steal-fit syndrome, please refer to the videos of angina, where we have discussed dipyridamol in very great detail. Refer angina. Okay, what is coronary steal syndrome? So these are the uses. Now what is the side effect? The most common side effect of dipyridamol is headache because of vasodilatation in head and diarrhea. Because cyclic AMP level inside the intestine causes diarrhea. It causes secretion of, increase in cyclic AMP causes secretion of chloride, etc. Okay. Why headache? Because of vasodilatation in cerebral arteries. So this is dipyridamol. Now the second drug we have is cilastazol. Now cilastazol, remember, as the word C is coming, C is the first alphabet, it is a phosphodiesterase 3 inhibitor, ABC 3 inhibitor. Okay, where it is given, remember, it is also given in stroke patient, and remember, it is given as a drug of choice in Berger's disease. In Berger's disease, remember, it is given as an add-on drug to aspirin. Okay, now Berger's disease is what? When there is formation of arterial rich thrombi in leg or limb arteries. So when a person will walk for a certain distance, due to reduction in blood supply, there is pain. When a person moves a certain distance due to blockage of blood supply, there will be pain. This is known as intermittent claudication because of reduction in blood supply in artery. So it is given when there is intermittent claudication, we give. Okay. What is the side effect? The side effect of cilastazol is exactly same like dipyridamol. It causes headache. It causes diarrhea due to dilatation of cerebral artery and cyclic AMP. Now, the next drug we have is pentoxifilin. Now, pentoxifilin, remember, it is multiple or non-specific phosphodiesterase inhibitor. It blocks many types of phosphodiesterase enzyme. It is also a rheological agent. Rheological agent means it will improve circulation. Why it improves circulation? It improves the compliance of RBC cell membrane. Compliance of RBC. Now what does it mean? Suppose this is an arterial rich thrombi. It is an arterial rich thrombi. Don't you think RBCs, they will find very difficult to move from this narrow space? So they have to squeeze it out. So if the cell membrane of RBC is very healthy, they can easily squeeze out from this cell membrane, this narrow space. This is known as improving circulation by improving the compliance of RBC cell membrane. Where this pentoxifilin is used, it is also given in peripheral vascular disease. Okay, peripheral vascular disease. Now just write two more drugs, other drugs for peripheral vascular disease like Berger's disease. We will write two more drugs. The first is, we will write is cyclandilate. Okay. And xanthinol nicotinate. Okay. Now these two drugs are also vasodilators, which will improve the blood supply in limb arteries. And they also improve circulation. But remember, these drugs, what we have found in long term, there is no benefit of using these drugs. So right now, these drugs are very rarely used. Till pentoxifilin, we use these drugs commonly. Okay. So this is all about the antiplatelet drugs. But we will write certain new antiplatelet drugs. But right now, these drugs are not approved. They are under trial. So that list, it is, remember, you will write for your reference. Under trial. So they are for your reference. You can skip this part also. Okay. So certain newer antiplatelet drug, we will write. The first drug is thromboxane synthase inhibitor. Now, what is this thromboxane synthase? We have already discussed that arachidonic acid. On this arachidonic acid, COX enzyme function. Okay? And this COX enzyme forms prostaglandin first G2, then PGG2 will form prostaglandin H2. And this prostaglandin H2 can form various substances like thromboxane A2. Now, this thromboxane A2 is synthesized by thromboxane synthase. This thromboxane synthase is present in platelets. Okay? So, we know that COX inhibitor is aspirin. But thromboxane synthase inhibitor, we have developed a new class of drug that specifically reduces the formation of thromboxane A2. So, they will inhibit the conversion of prostaglandin H2 into thromboxane A2. Okay? While COX enzyme acts on arachidonic acid, that will form prostaglandin G2. So, the drugs are, we will write desoxybane. The drugs are desoxybane, desmagrel, pimagrel, isbogrel. So, these drugs are being tried under trial for MI and stroke as an antiplatelet drug. Okay, this is a new drug under trial, that is Ozagrel. Ozagrel is under trial for bronchial asthma because thromboxane A2 can also cause bronchoconstriction as well. Okay, so this is a new class of drug, but it is not approved yet. It is still under clinical trial, and among them, try to remember desoxybane word. Okay, try to remember the name desoxybane. Now, the second class of drug we will write is thrombin receptor antagonist. Remember, thrombin, we have already discussed that thrombin causes platelet aggregation. Now, thrombin is released by the platelet. There are thrombin receptors on platelet which can cause platelet aggregation. So, we are developing thrombin receptor antagonist. The drugs are teritroban. How to remember? Trob means thrombin, AN means antagonist. Deltroban and sultroban. Okay, so these are the drugs. And lastly, we will write a drug, Ridogrel. Now, Ridogrel is a mixture of first two drugs. Ridogrel is a mixture of first two drugs. It is dual thromboxane A2 synthase inhibitor, the first drug, and it is also thrombin receptor antagonist. So, it is a mixture of first two drugs which we have discussed, Ridogrel. Okay, so it's a mixture of first drug, second drug, that is Ridogrel. Okay, dual drug. So, this is all about the antiplatelet drugs. Now, let's talk about the class of a drug known as proplatelet drugs. Proplatelets. So, proplatelet drugs, remember, they will increase platelet function. Okay. Now, let's see how normally platelet division occurs. Suppose this is a bone marrow. We know that all the RBC, WBC and platelets, they are formed in bone marrow. Okay. Or blood cells. In bone marrow, remember, there is a cell known as stem cells. Okay. Now, these stem cells, they form megakaryocyte. Okay, now these megakaryocyte, they are very big molecule. Small chipping will occur and small platelet will come into the blood. Small platelets will come into the blood. But remember, stem cells and megakaryocytes are present in bone marrow. Now, which chemical causes makes this stem cells form megakaryocyte and platelet? Remember that growth factor is known as thrombopoietin. Thrombopoietin. And remember, this thrombopoietin is synthesized in liver. This thrombopoietin is synthesized in liver. And also remember, interleukin 11 also does the same thing. Interleukin 11 and thrombopoietin increases formation of platelets. They increase formation of platelet. Okay. Now let's see what are the drugs we have which can increase platelet formation or increase platelet function. Try to remember thrombopoietin and interleukin 11. Okay. So let's see pro-platelet drugs. So we will write a mnemonic of those drugs, that is REAL O. Okay. Write a mnemonic REAL O. R stands for romiplostim. Okay. R stands for romiplostim. Now what is romiplostim if you talk about the structure and use? Structure and use. Now this romiplostim, we will write romiplostim. Its structure is, it is just like an antibody. You know there are two components of an antibody. So one is Fab fragment and we have an Fc portion. This is the structure of an antibody. Okay. Now the point is, in this Fab portion, we have attached thrombopoietin. We have attached a molecule known as thrombopoietin. So its Fab portion will contain thrombopoietin. So we have attached thrombopoietin to an antibody. Okay. And this Fc portion is a portion of Ig and immunoglobulin. Now, if you will give this drug, remember it is given by subcutaneous injection. And if you will give this drug, can we say it will go to the bone marrow and it will increase the formation of platelets because it is just like thrombopoietin? So where it is given, right now this drug has been approved for chronic ITP. ITP stands for idiopathic. That means we don't know what is the cause. Thrombocytopenic purpura. In this condition, the level of platelet reduces in the body. So it is given in ITP. Chronic ITP, that is idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura. Now the next drug we have is, we will write L-trombopag. And a similar drug, Avatrombopag. And Leucotrombopag. Okay. Now how to remember their names? It's very easy. You are seeing thromb word is coming. That means thrombopoietin. Thrombopoietin. So as you are seeing T-R-O-M-B word is coming, what is this? Remember, these drugs are thrombopoietin. Thrombopoietin. And as you are seeing AG word is coming. AG. AG means they are thrombopoietin agonist. So they will go to the receptors of thrombopoietin and they can directly stimulate the receptors of thrombopoietin present on megakaryocyte. Suppose this is a megakaryocyte. This megakaryocyte, it contains thrombopoietin, TPO, let's write the short form of thrombopoietin receptor. So these drugs, they will go and stimulate thrombopoietin receptor. Okay. So where these drugs are used and how they are given, remember these drugs are oral drug. These drugs are oral drugs. And what are the uses? They are given in chronic ITP, that is idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura. And they are also given in chronic liver disease. Can you tell me why in liver disease? Because in liver disease, the level of thrombopoietin reduces. Thrombopoietin is synthesized in liver. So if there is no thrombopoietin, give this thrombopoietin receptor agonist from outside. And the last drug we have is very important drug, that is Oprelvykin. Last drug we have is Oprelvykin. Now how to remember Oprelvykin? Kin word is coming. It's a type of interleukin. So kin word is coming. So it's a type of interleukin. Okay. Now which type of interleukin? As you are seeing a word is coming, ELVE. ELVE means it is interleukin 11. Okay, it's interleukin 11. Now, where it is given, remember it is given by subcutaneous injection. And it is the drug of choice for thrombocytopenia due to chemotherapy. Chemotherapy means anti-cancer drug. Okay? Thrombocytopenia due to chemotherapy or anti-cancer drugs. Because anti-cancer drugs, they suppress bone marrow. Okay? Anti-cancer drugs, they suppress bone marrow. So this is all about antiplatelet and proplatelet drugs. So thank you very much. In next section, we will discuss about anticoagulant and procoagulant drugs.